God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Try again. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time. Well, I hope you believe that this morning. We've got an incredible service in store. I am so excited about what we have going on. It's going to blow your mind how many things we got going on this morning. It's going to be great. I'm going to start off, I want to let you know about a few things that are happening around these parts. You'll see out in the foyer, there's a tree and a table set up. That is our angel tree. We still need about 4 host families. Just go to that table after service. There'll be someone there, and you can get a little paper angel, and it will have a child with a gift that they need on there. And so we would love to be able to get all of those angel trees taken care of. So please see Michelle at the table in the foyer if you want to be a part of that. Tonight is our all-church Thanksgiving dinner. And if you've never been here for one of them, you need to fast for lunch today because it is going to be amazing. All right. We got the whole Thanksgiving feast going on, turkey and mashed potatoes and stuffing and pecan pie, and it's just going to be great. We do ask, though, that you help by bringing something. You can see in the foyer, in the bulletin there, what you need to bring based on what your last name is. That will help us out. Right after the service this morning, we could use many of you to help out. First of all, there's a table in the gym that has dishes on it. If you brought a dish for one of the funerals that we've had recently, or if you're just missing a dish and you think that it might be here, go check it out. Take care of those dishes. That way we can have them out of our way. Also, right after the service this morning, we're going to be setting up all the tables and chairs in the gym and the foyer for the meal tonight. So if you can just stick around for a few minutes after the service this morning and help out with that, that would be great. Then tonight, bring your food with you at 5 p.m., our new playground will be open for business, all right? So come, that's right. Let's hear a hand for all of our workers. That was quite the project out there. I think it saved us a couple $1,000s from all of our volunteers. There was 3 huge flatbed trailers full of stuff that came, and we had a bunch of folks helping out, unloading it, putting it together. So 5 o'clock tonight, the playground opens. 6 o'clock is the meal. And then after the meal, if you could stick around and help tear down all the tables and chairs and clean up, that would be a great help to us. Also, as you probably noticed, there's our Celebrate the Light table in the foyer. We're doing things a little different this year. Our attendance has grown incredibly every year for Celebrate the Light, and we're a little concerned about space. So we have tickets this year. We have a pile of tickets for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And we ask that you put your name down and how many tickets you take. And we're only printing 500 for each night. And so be sure to get tickets. Feel free to take a few for every night, and invite somebody and then give them the correct ticket. But then if you don't get them given away, please bring them back and then put next to your name. There's a slot for the number of tickets that you return. So we're just trying to make sure that we're good hosts and that we can accommodate everyone. If you have a business or if there's a community bulletin board somewhere that you're aware of, please take some posters. We've got a couple sizes out there. Hang them up. Get the word out. We're expecting a crowd of over 1,000 this year, and so we're excited about that. We appreciate your help. All right. Now that we've got all the business out of the way, let's just take a couple of moments, bow our heads, prepare our hearts for worship this morning.
morning. We're happy to worship with you this morning. Just give you a report on our quizzers yesterday as our little ones prepare to do handbell special this morning. If you were a Bible quizzer yesterday, would you stand up for us? We hosted for the Southwest Oklahoma District the quiz meet here at our church. There were lots of churches from our district that participated, and these were our quizzers. And we came in what place? First place. And we had, so let's give them a hand. And we also had one perfect score. Austin Wood had a perfect score yesterday. Let's give him a hand too. All right. Our handbell group is going to start making their way up here. This is our group that has been practicing the last couple Wednesday nights during Route 252. We've been working on a handbell special to share with you for this Thanksgiving. And part of worshiping is making a joyful noise, and that's what we're going to be doing this morning with our handbells.
Thank you, children. That was awesome. That was a joyful noise if I ever heard one. That is our theme for the day. You're going to hear the choir and orchestra making a joyful noise here in a minute. And our desire is that you just celebrate God with us this morning. Well, as an act of our worship, we want to give back to God out of the blessings that he's given to us. So I'd ask the ushers to come forward at this time and prepare to receive this morning's tithes and offerings. And let's just bow our heads for a moment of prayer over our offering this morning.
Father, we gather here this morning just thankful for all the many blessings that you've given us. And we are so thankful for our church family and for the children and the workers and all the folks that are here that help us bring such a joyful service to you. We just ask you to watch over us and guide us and help us be joyful givers. And may you bless the gifts and the givers as we bring our tithes and offerings to you this morning. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done wonderful things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the people with equity.
All the blessings. Thank you, choir. And congregation, aren't you glad that you can lean on arms that are everlasting? Arms that never grow weary or tired? Arms that do not give out, but they are always there to hold us up and to give us strength for each day. Well, I was thinking while I was sitting in Sunday school this morning, the key word for this service is, do not be afraid. Our Sunday school lesson was about surprises. And sometimes surprises kind of interrupt our life, and we're not sure what to think. Well, let me just say to you, this service will be a surprise. Do not be afraid. We have several things in store for you this morning that I believe can be a very appealing and a very significant moment in our encounter with God, as we experience Him and His grace today. The first part of that is going to be the act of communion. It'll be a little different than we normally do communion. There are several different words that the Christian church down through the ages have used to call communion. Most times in the Church of the Nazarene, we simply hear it as communion. Another common phrase is that of the Lord's Supper. Let us come to the table. There's another term that it's not used very often in Nazarene circles, but it's a very significant term when it comes to a reference of communion. And it is the word, the Eucharist. The Eucharist is a very significant word for us as we think of communion today in this month of Thanksgiving, this month of November. It is a Greek word, and it simply means gratitude. It comes from two Greek words, first word being you, which means to show. And the second word is charis, which means grace or favor. You put the two together, the Eucharist, and we have come together to show favor, or what we might call gratitude. I've noticed that several of you are posting each day in this month of November, what you are thankful for. Our celebrating communion today is a special moment in which we take the elements, the cup, and the bread. We eat and we drink as a proclamation to God that we are grateful, that we are grateful for the gift of life that He has given to us. We are grateful that Jesus was willing to bear our sin. He was willing to take my punishment. He was willing to become the sacrificial lamb. And our eating the bread and drinking the cup becomes a declaration of our gratitude for Jesus' willingness to die on the cross so that He could defeat sin and death, and that He would declare our freedom in Christ to live eternally. Here in just a few moments, our praise team and the choir will be leading us in songs of praise. They are very beautiful songs that speak of thanksgiving, of gratitude, just a recognition of what God has done for us. There will be four songs. It will take about 15 minutes for us to sing through the worship set. And during that time, I am going to encourage you to find a place throughout the sanctuary where you receive the elements. The communion trays are across the front of the sanctuary, and then they're across the back of the sanctuary. And while we are singing together, I would encourage you to go and get the elements, the bread and the cup, and then for you, in an expression of gratitude, that you would take and eat the bread, and you would take and drink the cup representing His life's blood shed for us. All the time, we're in this spirit of thanksgiving and gratitude as we listen, as we sing, as we experience the presence of God through a heart full of joy and through the celebrating of the Eucharist. For me, and I've had time to think about this week, so it's no surprise for me. So it'll be a little bit different for you, but I decided that this during this time, as we start to sing, I'm just going to go right to the elements, right to a tray, and I'm going to pick up a piece of bread and pick up the cup. They're both contained in one tray, so you just have to go to one spot, take the cup and the bread, and I'm going to go to a spot in the sanctuary where I can see the words on the screen and I can sing with joy and thanksgiving from my heart to the Lord. And during that time, I just believe that there's going to be a moment that out of my being, there will be a great expression. God, I just want to thank you, and I will eat the bread and drink the cup. For some of you, you may want to return and sit at your pew, or maybe kneel at your pew, or come around the altars and kneel. Wherever you would like to find a place in the sanctuary to be mindful of God's grace that he has given to you, given to us, and we express our gratitude by doing what he told us to do, that whenever we do this, we do it in remembrance of him, not only remembering his sorrow and his suffering, but also proclaiming with a great sense of anticipation his coming again. We believe that the invitation to the table is open to all believers. You do not need to be a member of the Church of the Nazarene to take communion today here with us. We just encourage you to take the element, and then as you share together, as you sing together, you will share a moment of God's grace as you eat and drink. So I hope those instructions are kind of simple. As we start to sing, Nathan will invite us to stand, and somewhere during the time of singing, four songs, go to a tray, pick up a piece of bread and a cup. Do it right there or return to your seat, but take a moment to remember what Christ has done. Will you bow your heads? And I will lead us to prepare our hearts to share together the Eucharist by praying. Lord Jesus, a couple thousand of years ago, you were preparing to become my sacrificial lamb. And today you have made us aware that the sacrifice that was required meant that you would allow your life, your body to be broken, and your life's blood to be poured out, so that there would be an atonement for my sins and for the sins of your people. And I pray that today, as we take this bread, may we recognize that it is the bread of your brokenness, and you willingly gave up your body for us. And then we will take the cup, and in an expression of gratitude and thanksgiving, we will remember that you shed your blood for me, for us today. So Lord, help us as we sing these songs. Songs that declare our thanksgiving. Songs that declare our tribute. Songs that just call us to give thanks to you. I pray that there would be a moment that we would receive your grace through the Eucharist. A ritual, a sacrament of gratitude. We love you today, and may these next 15 minutes be a time that we encounter you in a special way. In Christ's name.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love.
From the rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever. And by the grace of God, He will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us.
For all that you've done, I will thank you. For all that you're going to do. For all that you've promised and all that you are. So all that has carried me through. Jesus, I thank you.
Thank you.
Congregation, if you'll be seated, we'll give a few moments before we pray together for our team to receive the elements that they haven't yet. So just keep in a spirit of prayer just for these next few moments, and then we'll close our Eucharist time with a prayer together. Lift your voices together as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray early in his ministry. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, it is my hope that that was a meaningful time of expressing praise and gratitude to our Lord today. He was here with us. He is here with us. And I believe that he received our prayers and our expressions of gratitude and thanksgiving today. So thank you for participating and for not being afraid of something a little bit different. But I want to say to you, do not be afraid, because we're not finished yet. We have something a little different today. Before I do that, I better make sure I look at my instructions. Boys and girls that are still here, you're dismissed at this time to go to children's church. So didn't want to forget that. If we have someone new here today with us, parents, you are invited to go out into the foyer and follow them upstairs. And after the service is over, you will be excused to go and pick them up there. We appreciate that. So the sermon today is interactive, okay? You will be involved. Again, I say, do not be afraid. I believe it can be of great significance and meaning as we share this service together. You will have the opportunity within the sanctuary to live out the message. Did you catch that? You will have the opportunity in the sanctuary, before we dismiss here, to live out this message together. I do want to say, I understand that it will put some of us outside of our comfort zone. It will be somewhat of a surprise, but I want to just encourage you today. Be open to what we have opportunity to do as we live out this message. I just believe that you will leave here today saying, God is doing something incredible in our congregation, in each of our lives together. So if you have your Bibles, let's turn to our text, which is in Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, and the paragraph is actually entitled, The Lord's Supper. In the NIV version, which you're saying, now wait a minute, Pastor. We already had the Lord's Supper. We already celebrated the Eucharist, and I know that. I understand that. But I told you, do not be afraid. Be ready for a surprise today, okay? So Matthew chapter 26, beginning at verse 17. When you found that, I invite you to stand for the reading of the Word of God. We will read through verse 29. Matthew 26, beginning at verse 17. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" Jesus replied, "Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time is near. I am going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared for the Passover. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me." They were very sad and began to say to one after the other, "Surely not I, Lord." And Jesus replied, "The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." And Jesus answered, "Yes, it is you." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." And then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom." The word of the Lord. Lord, I now open my heart to hear and obey your word. Amen. You may be seated. Oftentimes we hear in this passage the preparation of the Passover. And I don't know about you, but I marvel at the provisions that Jesus was able to make prior to the occasion. Or some of us, we hear the part about the betrayer. And we get hung up on it. I don't know about you, but this morning just reading the word again out loud, I was just some sense of being overwhelmed that Jesus would look Judas in the face and say, "Yes, it is you." Apparently, no one else caught the message. But as I listened to the word, this interaction between Jesus and Judas, I kind of got hung up as I read through that passage. I mean, I would begin to think, why would Judas do that? Or some of us go on to the communion portion of the passage where Jesus took the bread and he gave thanks and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, and this is my body." Or then in verse 27 when he said, he took the cup and he said, "Drink from it, this is my blood." But I think that the part we often miss, and the part that I believe God wants us to hear today on November 17th, 2013, is the part that occurs in verse 20 and in 29. Verse 20 says, "When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. Do you get this picture of an intimate relationship that's occurring between Jesus and his followers? This intimate picture that says there was this fellowship, there was this connection that was happening between Jesus and his disciples. That's the kind of connection that I want to experience with Jesus and with you. We are His disciples. We are His followers. And I believe that today, in the midst of gathering together, Jesus wants us to recline at the table. And then in verse 29, Jesus, it says, "When I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Do you get the picture that his kingdom, this relationship, this connectedness that Jesus was speaking about in verse 20 is a connection that's going to last forever? It's a connection that he wants us to experience over and over and over again as a part of his body. So as I began to see that, it seems to me that what's about to take place here as the body of Christ is a vital part of the Eucharist in terms of understanding the role that God has given to us to express to Him thanksgiving, but then to also discover the connection between the body of Christ. It was something that these disciples shared together, this fellowship, and he wants us to experience it as well. When we read the account of the early church, the early day disciples after Jesus left and returned back to heaven, you see this story over and over again of these believers experiencing God in incredible ways. And I think that the story in the book, particularly beginning in the book of Acts, gives to us a picture of what we are to be like as part of his body. In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, it says, "They," speaking of the disciples, "they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer." This verse starts with a very powerful word. It is the word devoted. The dictionary defines devoted as having strong loyal or loyalty for something or someone. In this case, the disciples were developing a strong love and loyalty to the teaching of Christ. To this teaching that the apostles had experienced firsthand, and now they were sharing it with other people. I think that to a certain degree, we here today understand this idea of the learning, the apostles' teaching. We understand that God has given us a provision so that we might follow his teaching. Later on in the verse, in the tail end of the verse, it speaks about prayer. And although we could learn more about prayer, I believe that we understand that it means that God wants us to commune with Him, to talk with Him, to share with Him our burdens and our concerns, but also to tell Him of our love and our devotion to Him. It talks about fellowship and the breaking of bread. There's much to say about fellowship today. The word is actually koinonia, and it has several meanings, but the most common has to do with the community or the team. I experienced koinonia this week. Friday, Saturday, as a group of many of you came and you worked and you came together as a team and shared the knowledge that you had. You shared the abilities that you had, and we put together a playground. Not just any playground, but a playground that we want to dedicate to our community so that boys and girls and their parents will come onto our campus. And somewhere along the line, you and I will have the opportunity to connect with them and share with them about the love of Christ. But that working together was the community, the koinonia, that speaks about here. But the last element of that verse is the verse that I want to focus on for the next few minutes. It's this idea of breaking of bread. Now, most of you, when I would say breaking of bread, you would immediately go to the tray, the cup, and the wafer, communion, the Eucharist, the Lord's table. And I definitely believe that as you read through Scripture, oftentimes when it speaks to us about what the disciples were doing, that they were breaking bread together, they were sharing communion. But I also believe there was a unique element of fellowship that occurred around the table that was significant to the body of believers called Christ. And it is that fellowship today that I want to challenge you to become involved in and engaged in this morning for about 10 minutes. Now, for me, I have discovered or I have created that there are 5 reasons why we break bread together within the body of Christ. Okay? 5 reasons. They're printed in the bulletin, and we're going to show you some of them here in the Scripture. 5 reasons why we break bread together. Number 1, we break bread together to welcome one another into the fellowship of believers. Welcome, acceptance. As you look around this room, there are people that you do not know. And as you break bread together, you will be saying to those people that you do not know, I don't know who you are yet, but I want to say, I'm glad that you're part of the fellowship. Scripture says in Acts 2:47, the people were praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. That's a powerful scripture. If you and I live out that scripture, do you understand what it means for us as a part of His body? It means that the Lord is going to add to our fellowship people who are being saved because we care enough about the kingdom of God that we want to welcome one another into the body of Christ. And so you break bread together to welcome one another into the fellowship of God. Secondly, we break bread together to offer encouragement to those around us. Encouragement to those around us. Acts 11:23 says, when he arrived and saw what the grace of God had done, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with their whole hearts. Romans 13:8, that is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. Galatians 6:2, carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. Colossians 4:8, I am sending him to you for the express purpose that you may know about our circumstances and that he may encourage your hearts. 1 Thessalonians 4:18, therefore encourage one another with these words. Hebrews 3:13, but encourage one another daily as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We break bread together to encourage each other in the faith. Number 3, we break bread together to express love and appreciation to one another. Love and appreciation to one another. John chapter 13 says, a new command I give to you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. Romans 13:8, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. 1 Peter 3:8, finally, all of you, be like-minded, be sympathetic, love one another, be compassionate and humble. Do you get the idea that the Word of God speaks to us and says, if we are going to be part of the body of Christ, we must offer love to one another, express appreciation for your involvement in our lives. Number four, we break bread together to initiate the healing of relationships. Jesus says, therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to them, then come and offer your gift. Then Jesus said later on in that same sermon, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Part of breaking bread together is the initiation of healing of relationships. And finally, the fifth reason we break bread together is simply to celebrate unity or oneness within the fellowship. Psalms 133 verse 1 says, how good and pleasant it is. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live. Say that word together with me. In. The psalmist had an understanding that if we are going to be the body of Christ, and although we are all different, we still got to come together in unity. 1 Corinthians 12 says, just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. Ephesians 4, verse 3 says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Do you get the idea as you hear the Word of God that God has called us to be a fellowship of believers that is unified, that is one body, glorifying God, connecting to one another? So we're going to do this today by breaking bread. Throughout the sanctuary, here across the front and in the back, there are baskets of fresh homemade rolls. Now tonight we're going to eat together, and Nathan shared, there's a lot of turkey, there's mashed potatoes, there's dressing, there will be some bread there tonight, and all kinds of salads and desserts and all that good stuff. Are you bringing pecan pie? Okay, so you're just hoping, you're stepping out in faith that someone's going to bring a pecan pie. Good. So here's how we're going to, this message becomes interactive. I'm going to pray a prayer, and the prayer has no amen to it. It simply stops, and then you live out the prayer, and you're going to go to one of these baskets, and this is what I encourage you to do. This is part of the surprise of the service. This is the part that's uncomfortable, but you're going to get you a piece of bread. And then you're going to begin to walk around the sanctuary, and I want to encourage you to break bread together with someone for one of the five reasons that we just shared. Those five reasons are going to be up on the screen here in just a moment. They're printed in your bulletin. I think you will remember the ones that you need to remember. As you look across the congregation, you're going to go to someone, and Brett, will you come, and can I use you as a sample? Here's what you're going to do. I'm going to give you the instructions. Brett's got a piece of bread, and I have a piece of bread. Now, I pretend I don't know. Did you eat it? I'm going to pretend for a moment I don't know Brett very well. Watch it, Ralph. And so, because I'm going to pretend I don't know him very well, and so I'm going to say, Brett, will you break bread together with me? I hope that in the next few days and weeks and months, we can get better acquainted. And I'm going to put my little piece of bread in front of him. We're going to take off just a little pinch and eat it together. It's not huge. It's not significant about how much bread or what's significant is I'm saying to Brett, Brett, I want to get to know you better. Any one of the five reasons I don't know, as you look among the congregation, I really, it's so important for us to connect together. And I just imagine that as you look across the room, there's somebody that you don't know very well. One of the neat things about working together the last two weekends, some of our newer people have been able to be there. Thank you, Brett. Have been able to be there and be a part. And so we've gotten acquainted. And some of you, I want to come to you and I want to say to you, will you break bread with me? Because I just appreciate your commitment to Christ, your loyalty to the church, your love of my family, and myself. I just want to say I appreciate you. Whenever you're done, there's over 500 rolls, by the way. So there's plenty of bread. So if you use up all a piece of bread and you want to get another one, you're welcome to until the bread is gone. And some of you, it's going to be really, you're going to be really uncomfortable doing it. I understand that. And I give you permission that you don't have to participate. It's all right. But I hope that you will just try at least to welcome somebody into the body of Christ. You bow your heads with me? Father, here in the next few moments, we're going to break bread. I'm not sure that it's all that you meant as we read the account of the early day church, but what I've come to learn as part of the body of Christ in the year 2013 is that it's very important for us as we connect and commune with you. And we have done that today, and I believe you've accepted our offerings of praise and thanksgiving. And we have remembered as we took the bread and the cup and this relationship that occurred between you and me. But Lord, it's not enough. Throughout your scripture, throughout your word, continually, over and over again, we find that there is, because we have a connection with you, there is a connection with us, the body of Christ. And so, Lord, as we move to this very surprising, new, interactive part of the message, may it have meaning. May it be a blessing to you. May it be encouragement to us. And may we once again experience your grace in the Lord. Thanks. We're going to turn some music on. You're free now to come and find a piece of bread. Go to 1, to 10, to 30, to 200, and break bread together. Let us break bread today.